Christian driver, thank you, Lord, for being the God that you are.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for being supreme, supreme above all supreme beings, O God.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, God, for your blessing, Lord, that we can't begin to count because you have multiplied every day, O God.
Thank you, Lord.
One of your writers said that morning by morning, we see brand new mercies, O God. And we thank you, God, for your mercy and for your grace, O Lord.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you, God, for your salvation, O God. For,
yes,
not because we merited, O God, but because of your love and your compassion, your kindness. You just reached down, O Lord, and pointed us out, picked us out, and made us yours, O Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For God, O God, we'll be eternally grateful, O God.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, God, for this place again, O Lord, your house. So you can speak from, O God. We pray, O God, you speak freely tonight, O God.
Yes, Lord.
Open your mouth wide and communicate your truths to us, O God, and give us ears to hear, O God, and hearts to believe what you're saying, O Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We pray for God's those who are here, for their obedience, O God, to set themselves together. We pray for those, O God, who couldn't make it tonight, O God, for whatever reason, that you look upon them, O Lord, with kindness, O God.
Yes,
we pray, O God, for the words. We pray, O God, that again you'll manifest your word, that you'll multiply it, and that you'll just that'll sink into our ears, O God.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Examine yourself, whether ye be in the faith. A lot of times when Paul writes, he's writing with two ideas. One, to confirm those who are true believers, and also to expose those who are not. This verse takes in that idea. When the Word of God goes forward, there's a time to make a self-examination. Now, if you found you're not in the faith, you have the choice. You can get in the faith, become a believer, or leave. It doesn't make sense to waste time here. Why do that? We realize there's an element in his church that are called tares, who are wasting time, but never really examine themselves to confirm that fact. He goes on to say, prove your own selves. Know you not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except to be reprobates. Reprobate is somebody who has the Word of God in a twisted, demonic format. God has given Satan a reprobated mystery. He believes he's right. And he believes God is wrong. And that's the only reason he can continue his fight that he has over the ages, because he believes ultimately he's going to win. What else can motivate him? He's not aware of the fact that he's going out the truth. He knows Jesus said that about him, but he doesn't believe that. Like his tares, he thinks Jesus does not have the truth. And he does. Now, realize there's no truth in him. But he'll come to realization in the day of his judgment when he's confined to hell. But keep that in the back of your mind, all right? looking at Cain again tonight. From a little different perspective. I've been looking at some scriptures for many, many years. I haven't taught on them because I felt like I had an incomplete picture. In fact, when the Lord, when the time comes, He'll make it so that I can teach on it. This is one of those subjects. We're going to read tonight about two groups. One group, prophesying Isaiah, he said their eyes, they have closed. And they're dull of hearing and haven't heard his word. He speaks of another group that doesn't say they close their eyes. He said the other group cannot hear his word, because you're the father, the devil. Which I took to mean for many years that you're the devil's until you get born again. Then you become God's. That's not what he's saying here at all. He said this earth has two different seeds upon it. Seed of Satan, seed of God. You read in Genesis, chapter 4, when Cain is born, Eve says something that for me did not fit for many years. Chapter 4. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. You can't find any proof in Cain's life that that's true. Had Cain come to Eve from the Lord, he should have displayed some of the qualities of the Lord. He displays none. And she bare again. Now it's commonly taught, because of that expression, that Cain and Abel were twins. Because you have one conception in verse number one. She conceived and bare Cain. And she bare again his brother Abel. Then it gets to the conflict. The real reason, the main reason, there's two of them, why God did not accept Cain's offering. Number one, his offering without blood. God devised a system to cover those in the Old Testament called the sacrificial system, whereby if they sin, they could kill an animal, and the blood from the animal would atone for their sins. Which Hebrews will later bring out, as we talked last year, it's impossible for the blood of goats and bullocks and so on and so forth to take away sin. So there was just a temporary fix to atone for sin until Jesus came with his own blood, which was perfect, and literally purchased the sacrifices of the Old Testament. But for the time being, they could bring animals. Without blood means the offerer saying, I have no sin. a doctrine that John would later on do with the New Testament. And he said, if we say we have no sin, we're liars. Because we all have it. We're born in sin. It says in Romans that Adam sinned, and so sin and death passed upon the entire human race. The only way you can prove sin and prove this whole Adam and Eve story is that everybody dies. Because the Creator said so. He said to Adam, in the day you eat the rib, surely die. And he did. And although he lived to be 930 years old, the day of the Lord lives 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day, and Adam died the day he ate. But death passed upon everybody as a result of it. That's the best proof I can offer somebody that God exists, that his word is real, solve the mystery of death. We can talk about some other means. But you can't explain it. Why everybody dies. You don't have to be sick to die. A lot of people die of what they call natural causes, which is contradiction by itself. Natural causes mean there's nothing physically wrong with you. Now, that works unless you include the sin issue. So what killed him? Sin. Sin is the ultimate killer. Whether you feel sick or not, whether you feel sinful or not, whether you sin or not, it's proof that everybody is born in sin because sin takes everybody out. There's a scripture I can't think of where it is right now, but it says that sin was in the world when there's no law. And when there's no law, if there's no law, you can't really accuse anybody of breaking the law. But to show how powerful sin was, it says sin killed people when there's no law to kill them with. It just killed all by itself. So, this man Cain has been an enigma. She says he's from the Lord. But again, there's nothing in his life, the little brief history we have, that shows he is from the Lord. A lot of times you get these stories in the Old Testament, and they get cleared up with just a verse in the New Testament. So it is with this one. Turn to 1 John. Israel. And unlike us, we fall in love. Our feelings get in the way, really. We fall in love, and it runs our life until you fall out. And the only thing about falling in love, the harder you fall in, the harder you fall out. And you can almost wish that I had never loved this person. Whereas God makes a decision to love with his whole heart. And all the pain and torment that goes with it when you have somebody who doesn't love you back the same way. That's the experience with Israel. He loved Israel. Israel broke his heart. Because he just put it all out there. Only God could do that. Married her. And eventually had to divorce her. But he still loves her. And will marry her again. So this next time he does it again, She'll be a different woman because she'll have been redeemed. And he'll make her heart like his heart, and she'll love him just as much as he loves her. And they'll live happily ever after. It'll be a long, long ever after. That's the ultimate thing. What manner of love? He bestowed upon us to such a degree that as we are right now, he calls us sons of God. I can't comprehend that. But so many times in our life, we appear to be everything but that. And there's so many flaws and shortcomings and transgressions and what have you, that we can't understand how he can make that statement here. But it's true because the world doesn't know us. Therefore, because of that fact, the world knoweth us not. Because it knew him not. The world couldn't comprehend Jesus. They couldn't comprehend his compassion, his grace, his love. They couldn't comprehend it because he was everything that the world standards of love weren't. Beloved, in case you understand it, now are we the sons of God. I love reading that verse. It gives me great hope. And as far as our future is concerned, it does not yet appear what we shall be, which clearly implies that we're not going to be this same way forever. We're going to break out of these bodies of death, because they all die. And worse than that, I think worse than dying, they corrode along the way. Yeah. My mother said several times, she said, I don't know why they call these and get old the golden years. These are the rust years. Everything is rusting out, falling apart, breaking down. You wake up and have a new pain for no reason. You think, well, what do I do? And it's just there, you know? Half of the night here, you got on glasses, like me. Because your eyes are deteriorating. I refer to life, look at life like a banana. You know what I mean? When you break it off the vine, it's dying right then because it's separated from the vine. Mm-hmm. And they ship them over here from Guatemala, whatever, and they're green. You can't eat it yet because it's not ripe. But it's still dead. You just pick a point along its death journey to eat it, which is when it gets yellow. Now it's good to eat. But let it lay around for a little while, then start turning brown. And you can't eat it anymore. That's what life is like. We're born. We're born cute little babies, but dead. Sin has already started working on us. The time we come in here and it keeps on working, and all the way through, and just keeps on doing different things, turns your hair gray, takes your hair out, it does things to you that you haven't done. Bill Cosby saying one time that when you start getting old, you don't grow hair in the place you want to grow hair, and you grow hair every place you don't want. Mm-hmm. Like in your nose, in your ears, and all that kind of stuff. And I said, just grow my hair like it grows my nose, I'd be okay. But that's not how it works. But thank God, it definitely appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope, not a wish, but a hope that's solid and built on the truth of God's word, in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. So anybody who's saved, you make it your point to live a purified life, although you still occasionally sin and fall short. But that's not your decision in life. Your decision in life to be like him. Yes. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins. And in him is no sin, which is why he's qualified to take ours away. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Does that mean you never commit sin? No, it means you don't sin as a way of living. It's a habitual way of life. You don't just practice sin. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. I'm sure those men he picked, those 12 apostles, just being around Jesus, impact their whole way of living. Their lives change. Had to, because they're around this man every day for 3.5 years who had no sin. It's got to affect you. You agree?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's a association begets assimilation. You become like what you run with. Birds of a feather flock together. Someone else got to tell us, express this. If you let out the dogs, you get up the fleas. It's just truths of life. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. What do you mean doeth righteousness? Who commits themselves to living a righteous life, doeth righteousness. Satan's going to come to this time and takes advantage and cause you to fall. But when you fall, you don't just lay there. Okay, I guess this is where I'm at now. You're disgusted with the fall, and you try to work right away and get back up again. Yeah. Ask God to forgive you and continue the race. But he that committeth sin, as is the habitual way of life, is of the devil. I'm showing you here. Whoever abides in him doesn't sin, but whoever commits sin is of the devil. You got two seeds. His and the devil's. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. For his seed remaineth in him. And he cannot sin as a way of life because he's born of God. Grady Benton is my father. Was my father. Long after he passed away, those that knew my dad, they see me say, some say Grady. Or Bishop Benton. Elder Benton. And they said, you're just like him. I went to the funeral, I went to the funeral. He said, you walk like him. You talk like him. Look like something never gonna happen. It's funny, we don't want to look like our parents when we're young. But when we get older, it's a sense of pride. You're just like your daddy, thank you. And you told me that when I was 20, and I said, really? I want to hear that. I'm like him because his seed is in me. I don't try to act like he talks, act like he acts. I watch myself on YouTube every once in a while. I can stand it. There's been occasions that, you know, just pass by the TV, shut hands on. And I look at it and say, oh, man. Looks just like him. I mean, like, to me, you know? I say, that's my dad. I watch as I'm on the board and everything, and the way he uses his hands and his mannerisms. And I do the same thing. Not because I'm trying to be that way. It's just natural. Can't help it. He says, who has his seed in them, they're going to naturally be like him. Without making yourself like him. And consequently, if you have Satan's seed in you, you're going to naturally be like him. Without even trying to be. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God. In this, the children of God are manifest and the children of the devil. Two children. The children of God and the children of the devil. And the question I began asking is, when did the children of the devil begin? When did their seed start in the earth. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. What did Cain do? He killed his brother. So therefore, he's not a man from the Lord. He didn't love God. And therefore says that he is not of God. Is that ready for this? We're on another level tonight. So the Bible says that a person who hates his brother is a murderer. And a person who hates his brother or sister or a member of this family, examine yourselves, you're not of God.
Amen.
If loving your brothers and sisters in this place is difficult, if for the most part you can do without them, you got the wrong spirit. Wrong seed is there. I know things are supposed to be this way, but this is how I am. Worst words come out of saints' mouth and they say, I can't stand so-and-so. Or I hate. I know we got to treat him right and everything. Well, if you have his seed, you just do it anyhow.
That's right.
And hate element is not there. It's just not there. That there's nobody in the family of God that you hate.
Amen.
There's nobody in the family of God that you don't like.
Amen.
No more than in your natural family. You might have some division in your natural family. But don't you talk about them.
Right.
Don't you say anything about them. That's blood. And we may have our differences, but we're all the same blood.
Yes.
We're all the same mother and same father. And when it comes down, when it goes down, we're going to stand together.
Amen.
Just the way it is. Whether they're right or wrong, good or bad, I'm on their side.
Right?
In this the children of God are manifest. And the children of the devil, whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. For this is the message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another, not as Cain, who was of that wicked one. He's the beginning of the seed on earth of the wicked one. He's the beginning of Satan's seed. And his deception kicked in from the very beginning when he made Eve think that she got a man from the Lord. Although the man from the Lord didn't show any of the Lord's tendencies or his seed at all. Not as Cain, who was of the wicked one, and slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil. Why were his works evil? His daddy's evil. And his brother's righteous. Why were Abel's righteous? Because he had a righteous seed in him. This is one of the things that was wrong with offering. Number two is offered. Without faith. Well, why'd you bring God an offering of faith if you feel like you have no sin?
Right.
Turn to Hebrews 11 for a minute. Just review that basic truth. It says in verse 2 that by faith, the elders obtained a good report from God. Not that the elders were all good, but because they acted to God in faith, God announced them and pronounced them as good. Verse 4, by faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. What was missing Cain's sacrifice? Faith. By faith, Abel offered can't offer it by his own self works. And told God, this is what you're getting. He knew that he had to, it was interesting, he didn't offer Satan an offering. He knew that they were a different class. He called himself a worshiper of God, the worshiping God his way. I know I got to bring you an offering. I'm going to bring you an offering that would be acceptable to Satan. And Satan's message, no matter where it's written, his message is always a message of personal effort. No sin at all. First time I read the Quran, that's when I come to understanding that you got two different gods. The God who wrote this book is not the God who wrote the Quran. Allah is a different God. And Allah is the God who promotes not atonement for sin, but self-righteousness. Islam is a religion of good works and doing good enough. Not at all. Whereas God makes it very clear come out the gate that all have sinned. You come short and you can't get together. You need a Savior.
Yes.
Islam does not promote the need of a Savior. Cain would fit very easily into the world of Islam today. With no problem. And Abel would. We can't. Because we recognize the fact that we're born sinners. And somebody has to save us from our sin. Somebody whose blood was pure with God and had the power to deliver us. Right? By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness. By which means he is what? His sacrifice. He got a witness from by his sacrifice alone that he was righteous. What did Abel do? Nothing. He just brought God an acceptable offering. And because his offering alone, messed up as he was, born a sinner as he was, God said, you're righteous based on this offering. The same thing he does for us. We offer him to Christ, we offer him to God, a sacrifice of Jesus, and believe in his sacrifice, and God says, because you believe in his sacrifice, I'm going to pronounce you righteous. Although you fall short every day. God testifying to his gifts. Same with us. What does God testify of? Jesus. And because you put your faith in Jesus, I'll testify of you too. And look upon us as if we were Jesus himself. Beloved, what manner of love the Father stood upon us. Beloved, now are we the sons of God because of Jesus. And because we don't know what kind of body Jesus has now, he says to us, it does not appear what you shall be. But we're going to be glorified. The idea of having a body that lasts forever is mind-boggling. God made Adam to live forever. Sin cut his life short. But what would it be like living forever, feeling good? To never have to see a doctor. Never have to wear glasses. Never have diseases in this world. To never even think about it. Wow. I was talking to Angie's father before he passed away. So you go to a place where there's no doctors. Now I sent it to him. I was carried away with myself. Place like this institution here don't exist there. No medicine. I doubt there are any beds in heaven. Because I can't find any place in the scriptures where you have to go to sleep. Right. Sleep is a remedy to offset the effects of sin. That's why God made the nighttime. And I learned from my wife that your body does its most self-repair between the hours of 10 o'clock at night and 2 in the morning.
That's right.
Those of you who stay up all night, you turn yourself a disservice. Like me. I've got her staying up late right now, but at least she sleeps in the morning sometimes. Right? Me, I stay up late at night and then get up in the morning. That makes no sense. My mother called that burning the candle at both ends. And in the middle, she says sometimes. She asked my wife one time. She was sick. She said, is she slowing down for me? So she told me some time afterwards. And she said, I don't know what to say to her. So I just told her, yeah, a little bit. I was lying. Well, I'll tell you, since last year, you slowed down a whole lot. He's going to go slow these days. He made the nighttime, first asleep. It says Revelation, there'll be no nighttime there. It says the gates never close at night because there'll be no night, because the sun shall light the universe, talking about the Son of God, will light the universe, and there'll be no nighttime, which I assume then there'll be no sleep. Well, that'd be like, really? Nothing's greater than you wake up and feel wide awake. Is that wonderful? When you're functioning all these cylinders, everything's going good that day. I try to think back to what I ate that day before and so on and so forth, so I can have this feeling tomorrow. But it never lasts 2 days in a row.
Right.
But it's a good thing just to feel wide awake and you're sharp in your mind. So, by faith, verse 5, Enoch. Verse 7, by faith, Noah. Verse 8, by faith, Abraham. Through faith, verse 11, Sarah. Verse 20, by faith, Isaac. 21, by faith, Jacob. 22, by faith, Joseph. 23, by faith, Moses. Then he gets the whole children of Israel. By faith, they, in verse 29, that by faith they passed through the Red Sea. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down. By faith, the harlot Rahab perished not with them. That believed not when she had received the spies with peace. And he goes and said, one more can I say, verse 33, who through faith did all kinds of things. Okay? So without faith, it says in the beginning of that chapter, it's impossible to please him. And that's why Cain could not please him, because they brought an offering to God without any faith. I don't really trust you always bringing me this, because I don't really need you. I'm okay. Like the world's doctrine one time. I'm okay, you're okay. Right? I'm as good as you are, you're as bad as me. No difference. Whether you believe in God or not, that was their doctrine. Now let's get into this a little bit deeper. Turn to Matthew chapter 13. I'm going to skip that. I'm going to go a little more direct. Turn to John chapter 8. I was going to call Matthew 13, 15, but didn't put in the notes. And also Acts 28, 27. Let's go to John chapter 8. Verse 30. As he spake these words, many believed on him. I imagine your belief was somehow expressed out loud. Maybe just to each other, or to Jesus said, you know, I believe in him. I believe on him. Because the ones who didn't believe on him, they expressed their unbelief out loud. At some point, it should come an open confession if you believe in Jesus. Right? Not just in your heart. Somebody who knows you ought to know you believe in Jesus.
That's right. That's right.
Right?
Amen.
Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue my word, what are you saying, Jesus? Believing on me starts the trip. But I don't call you any of my disciples unless you continue in the same thing that caused you to believe in me. They believe on him because of his words. So now what do you do after that? Continue in his word. He says, now you're my disciples indeed. And your reward for that continuous belief is that you should know the truth. This is the most underrated promise in the Bible. Blessing and prosperity, preachers don't touch it. But it's the greatest blessing and prosperity verse there is. You should know the truth. I mean, what more is there in life? What's there greater in life than to know the truth? On what?
Everything.
Everything. And the truth shall make you free from what? All deception. You cannot be deceived. I like that. Cannot be hoodwinked. Cannot be bamboozled. The rock can't fall on you. They answered him, "We be Abraham's seed. And we're never in bondage to any man." What? Don't you realize you're under the Roman Empire? Right then? The Roman Empire represents their seventh bondage in their history. How can they say that? Because you're the seed, the devil, and he's a liar. And they believed it. See the difference? How sayest thou? I told you. The tares don't understand the wheat. They think the wheat is wrong. How can you say, you shall be made free? We're already free. We've never been in bondage. Totally, completely deceived. They forget about Egypt. They were born in bondage. Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome. They've got a whole history of bondage, but we've never been in bondage. Or to say that because you've ever received the devil. He just lied to you and said, "Yeah, I'm bondage. You're okay." And Jesus didn't bother to point that out to him. He didn't say, "You lost your mind." And check it out. I mean, is that the way the enemy comes at you? How in the world can you say, you're saying the truth, and they come back to the internet and say, how can you say that? And then try to correct your doctrine. You're dealing with a lot of these seeds on the internet when you go online. And you get frustrated with it. And you try to figure out the way to straighten them out. And you realize that you can't. And so you give them one liner, give them a final blurb and say, okay, later. I said it so many times. I wouldn't waste time going on a website that I don't believe. That's the thing about Satan's seed that amazes me. They'll keep on coming on. This side to find fault with it. Well, just don't go on anymore. We're not going to change.
Right.
This is what we believe. We're all deceived. He's a false prophet, so leave it alone.
Right.
We're going to keep on pointing out. Go over again. Just okay. You made it real clear. Then go to the other side or start your own. Why do you keep coming back to visit? To point the same thing out again?
Mm-hmm.
What's wrong with us? That's what he says he does.
Mm-hmm.
They can't do anything else. They have to keep on coming back because they can't help that. Why? Because he brings them back. Jesus answered them, "Verily I say unto you, whosoever committed sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever." What's the servants here? The tares. Where are they now? In the house. They said they want to abide there forever.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, we'll let them both grip together. But I'm going to kick them out of the house pretty soon. But the Son abideth ever. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my father, and you do that which you have seen with your father. Two different fathers. Two different seeds. They answered and said to him, "Abraham is our father." Jesus said unto them, "If you were Abraham's children," he doesn't debate him being the father. He said, "You're not his children." He's your father, but you aren't his children. You're somebody else's children. You come out of the lineage of Abraham, but you're a different seed. just as a different seed came out of Eve, and two different seeds came out of her. One of the father of the devil, and one of God. One offered to God what he wanted, the other offered to God something different. He said, yeah, Abraham's your father. I know that, but you're not his children. If you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me. A man that told you the truth, which I have heard of God, this did not Abraham. So if Abraham's seed, his children, you would believe the truth and walk in the truth. He's your father, not his children. They said to him, we be not born of fornication. My commentary, when I was reading, so that was a slap in Jesus' face, because rumor was that Mary was pregnant before they came together. And therefore they said, Jesus is born of fornication. And when Satan gets against the wall and pinned in the corner, he'll say anything. They're telling Jesus that you're born of fornication. We're not. We have one father, even God. Which is to say that God is your father, in spite of what you claim to be. Jesus says, understand? If God were your father, you would love me. There's the proof. Why? For I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. Because you're a different seed. And your seed, the seed you said you're the father of the devil, you can't hear my word. He didn't say to this group that your eyes you have closed, and your ears are dull of hearing, and if you should see with your eyes, and hear with your ears, and be converted, and actually heal thee, he didn't say to this group. He says, this group, you can't hear my word. Ain't about closing your eyes. You can't hear my word, period. You don't have the ability to close your eyes to it. You can't hear. Why? Your father. You are your father, the devil. And the lust of your father, you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. What did the same group actually do eventually before it was all over? Murder Jesus. Because that's what their father would have done. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own. For he is a liar, and the father of lies. And because he tells the truth, you believe me not. Which of you convinces me of sin? He said, which one of you can prove I'm a sinner? Nobody answered that question. I mean, what a great thing to say to throw in the world's face. He says, Satan is another scripture says, Satan's come and found nothing in me. He couldn't accuse Jesus. Imagine that. No wonder he could say to us, all those letters of Revelation end up saying that he that overcometh. He's talking about the person who overcomes the situation of that particular church. So whosoever cometh, then he gives promises to it. But he tells his seed, he says, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And you're my seed. You're going to overcome, period. Good news.
Yes.
He that is of God heareth God's words. You therefore hear them not, because you're not of God. Got different daddy. And his word. It's impossible. Again, go back to being in the class. Examine yourselves when you be in the faith. If the word of God is hard to hear, it doesn't make sense, then you might want to check out your heritage. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, say we not well that thou art a Samaritan? Now they go totally left. They knew that Jesus was not a Samaritan. But what is their daddy's characteristic? He's a liar and an accuser of the brethren. Nothing worse than being accused of in that day was being accused of being a Samaritan. because they were a mixed lineage. They weren't pure Jews. They had mingled with some seed of the world. Say me not whether thou art a Samaritan, hast the devil. I'm always amazed of times when I have been called a devil or asked to leave my house because they said I had a devil. This happened to me more than a dozen times in my life. You have the devil in you.
Yeah.
Get out, Satan, rebuke you. Oh, they go all cursing. And I can't be fast enough. Then it's in the bedroom. Why don't you come over? What? I'll never be back again. And why would you invite the devil back to your house? That's the last thing I asked that person. I said, why don't you invite the devil back home? I mean, the last thing you're convinced I was the devil, put me out. Now you're okay again. Now the devil can come back in, huh? I said, in any respect for me, you wouldn't invite me back in again. If I'm the devil you say I am, I don't want to come back again.
Right.
You're too godly for me. Jesus answered, I am not the devil. But I honor my Father, and you do dishonor me. And I seek not my own glory. There is one that seeketh and judgeth. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. Look at what is about Jesus. When they're going to persist in being who they are, then he starts saying things that really, really hurt. Keep my saying, you'll never die. Then said the Jews unto him, now we know that I was the devil. Why did Jesus say that? So they would know that. He wasn't trying to save them. He's trying to show them who they were. And they're starting to tell him who he is. Abraham is dead. And the prophets. And thou said, if a man keep my sayings, he shall never taste of death. Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead? And the prophets are dead. Whom makest thou thyself? Who do you think you are? Jesus answered, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom you say that he's your God. He said, you say that. And you say he's your God. I came forth from him, doing his works, giving his message, and you can't hear it or believe it, yet you say he's your God. It's funny, the whole world believes in God. Somewhere or another. I want to write an article. Lady, don't mind. Don't call him a supreme being. It's been in my mind. People who are born with God never refer to God as a higher power.
Right.
They don't. They never call him the man upstairs. They never call him a supreme being. They never call him a spirit. It's not the ones whose seed is of the devil. They refer to God as a higher power.
Right. Right.
Well, based on what? What makes him a supreme being in your mind? They couldn't tell you. We know what makes him a supreme being, the power to keep his word.
Mm-hmm.
Ask him what makes him a supreme being supreme, and no one, he just is. Well, why? I was calling there. Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say I know him not, I should be a liar like unto you. But I know him. Isn't it wonderful to say you know him?
Yes.
Is it wonderful to say I know him? I know Jesus. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. I love this verse. And he saw it. And was glad. Abraham had been dead for a couple thousand years at this point. And he said, Abraham saw my day. What do you mean, Jesus? Abraham knew me. He met me. And he rejoiced when he saw me. And was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, and they're being real liberal with the time, thou art not yet 50 years old, He died at 33. Most commentators said when he spoke these words, he was around 30. So they said 50 for good measure. If they said he is 500 years old, that's not old enough to have known Abraham. 1,000 years old would not be old enough to have known Abraham. But it said 50. And hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. I predated Abraham. I predated the earth. I'm the firstborn of the creation of God. That means God made him first. It means that he's the firstborn of the creation of God, and that he's the one that was the facilitator in making the creation. I brought the earth into existence. That's what I'm saying. Then they took up stones to cast at him. Why did they do that? Because of the father, the devil. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going to the midst of them, and so passed by. Lord willing, I want to pick this up again Sunday, okay? Where it came. Offering time.